How's everybody doing? And welcome to From the Vault episode 200. I just want to say thanks to everyone who has subscribed, liked, and supported me on this channel with this series over nearly 5 years, and to those who have been here even longer, as the channel itself has been going nearly 12 years strong. You guys are the absolute best, and your support has been outstanding. Keep it up, I've got a ton planned going forward. Now then, for the new viewers, the first-time viewers, hi, my name is James. I've been a wrestling fan since 1994 and a wrestling content creator since 2010. Since October 2017, I've been producing weekly episodes in a series called From the Vault, where I choose a topic from wrestling's past and then I talk about it. I give some facts, give my opinions on it, and then interact with my audience on what they think on that certain topic. No opinion here is wrong. Everyone is entitled to their own opinion, and there's no judgment here by anybody. So if you like a wrestling channel that isn't ran by a toxic asshole and doesn't feed into any drama, click that subscribe button, click that notification bell, like, comment, share, and enjoy all the content, and most of all, thank you. Now then, Sting and TNA. A lot of people guessed the wrestler in question when I put a quote out there, but they weren't able to guess the time period for that wrestler. Why Sting and TNA for episode 200? Well, a couple of reasons. First, spoilers, I'm saving Sting and WCW for September's month-long retrospective. Number two, TNA's 20th anniversary is this weekend, and Sting was a prominent wrestler in that promotion. And number three, if you put a zero next to 20, it's 200, it's episode 200 this week, it all works out. But without further ado, it's showtime, folks. Now, most people forget that Sting actually did make a few TNA appearances before his main run with the company. He signed a four-match deal in 2003, also doing a Mike Tenay sit-down interview called Behind the Paint. The matches Sting would be a part of in 2003 were, at the first anniversary show, Sting teamed with Jeff Jarrett to face and defeat AJ Styles and Six-Pac. In November, Sting then challenged NWA World Champion Jeff Jarrett, winning the match by disqualification. The following week, Sting and AJ Styles defeated Jeff Jarrett and Lex Luger, and finally, in December, Sting defeated Jeff Jarrett in a non-title match. Sting would make one final appearance in March 2004 after plugging his new DVD, Moment of Truth, which parts of it were filmed in the asylum and some TNA wrestlers were used in it. Sting was an enforcer in a four-way match where Raven defeated Abyss, AJ Styles, and Ron Killings. Sting would stay out of the pro wrestling spotlight for the rest of 2004 and 99% of 2005. That was until the end of the Turning Point pay-per-view in December, where after Jeff Jarrett retained his NWA World title, the lights went out, a scorpion appeared on the video screen, and then Sting's trademark trench coat, baseball bat, and boots were on a chair in the middle of the ring with a spotlight on them. Sting was set to make his return to TNA in 2006. His return would be at the Final Resolution pay-per-view in January, where he and Christian Cage would face Jeff Jarrett and Monty Brown in the tag team main event of the show. Sting and Christian got the victory in the match when Sting got the decision on Jarrett. Not long after, on an episode of Impact, Sting made his first televised pro wrestling appearance in nearly 5 years, and he announced his retirement, said that Final Resolution was just that, his final resolution, said that this was a proper way to say goodbye unlike 5 years earlier. He walked up the ramp, through the tunnel, and he was seemingly gone for good. That was, however, until Eric Young of Team Canada and Planet Jarrett started acting paranoid. He was believing that Sting wasn't really gone for good, and he'll be coming back to TNA. Jarrett told him that he was gone for good, and to prove it, he'll send cameraman for hire Alex Shelley to record Sting in California to show that once and for all, he is retired. Alex did do that until he was eventually caught by Sting. Sting told him that if this is what Jeff Jarrett wants, this is what he'll get. And at Destination X, Steve Borden will be coming. And come Steve Borden, he did. Street clothes, no paint. He made the save for Christian from Planet Jarrett until the debut in TNA of Scott Steiner. They destroyed him, Steiner recliner, and then a guitar shot. Sting was now back in TNA for one reason, and that was to rid the company for good of Jeff Jarrett. He wanted revenge, and the best way to do that was TNA's version of War Games called Lethal Lockdown. It would be Sting's team versus Jarrett's team in the first proper Lethal Lockdown with the roof coming down on top, and Sting's team won the match. The Sting-Jarrett feud would continue over the next 6 months. For Sacrifice, it would be Jarrett and Steiner versus Sting and a mystery partner, but Sting would let Jeff Jarrett pick his partner. Sort of. Jarrett had a choice between Tunnel Number 1 and Tunnel Number 2. Each tunnel had a wrestler behind it, and if he didn't choose either tunnel, those wrestlers would be null and void, and new ones would be their next offer. The first week, Jeff passed, so Sting introduces both guys game show style. Tunnel Number 1 was Buff Bagwell, Tunnel Number 2 was Lex Luger. The following week was an offer of just one. Scott wanted to take the deal, but Jeff declined once again. This time, same thing as the week before, game show introduction, and that tunnel was Scott's brother Rick Steiner. Since Jeff passed not once but twice, he made the choice to make it Sting's choice, and that choice became the undefeated Samoa Joe, and at Sacrifice, Sting and Joe would win the match. Sting was a part of the King of the Mountain match at Slammiversary to make sure Jeff didn't win, but in the Orlando Screwjob, Jeff ended up winning the match and the World Heavyweight title. The decision was made final after the pay-per-view, but in exchange for that, there would be a four-way at Victory Road to determine Jeff's next opponent. Sting won the match at that pay-per-view and became the number one contender to the title. At Hard Justice in August, we got Sting versus Jarrett for the NWA title. Christian was in Sting's corner, and it looked like Sting had the match won. That was until Christian hit Sting with a guitar and cost him the match. Sting left for 2 months in the build for Bound for Glory. It would be Jeff Jarrett versus Sting one more time, title versus career. Sting no-sold the guitar shot from Jarrett, ended up making him submit to the Scorpion, and Sting was the new NWA World Heavyweight Champion. But Sting's reign as world champion didn't last long. His next program began at the following pay-per-view, Genesis, where Abyss became the number one contender to the world title. The two faced each other at the pay-per-view for the belt. Sting attacked the referee and shoved Abyss into a stack of barbed wire tables. He would be disqualified, and because of the rarely used slash way to protect somebody, TNA rule that the belt can change hands on a disqualification, Sting lost the world title to Abyss. Sting and Christian would chase the belt over the next two pay-per-views, Abyss retaining at Turning Point in December, while Christian won the belt at Final Resolution in January. Sting wanted to reason with the monster, even referring to him by his real name, Chris. Sting wanted him to leave his manager, James Mitchell, even telling the world that Abyss went to prison for shooting his father in the back. We later find out that Abyss's mother is the one who did it. Abyss took the blame, and Mitchell knows about it. The reason Abyss is with him is because if he does him wrong, he'll send his mother to prison. Sting would face Abyss over the next two pay-per-views, Against All Odds and Destination X. Sting won both matches, won a prison yard match, first to put their opponent in a shark cage wins, and the other was the infamous Last Rites match, the casket match where the casket is on a platform, you put your opponent in it, and then the casket rises after the match. It looked like after writing James Mitchell out for a bit and after the Last Rites match, Sting had changed Abyss. They even tagged on an episode of Impact, but when James Mitchell returned with Abyss's mother, Abyss came back to him. Sting and Abyss would be on opposite sides of Lethal Lockdown in April, as Sting was on Team Angle, Abyss was forced to be on Team Christian. Person who gets the decision gets a world title shot. Sting got the decision after the returning Jeff Jarrett hit Abyss with a guitar full of thumbtacks. Sting and Kurt Angle would get shots at the world title at Sacrifice against Christian Cage, and that would be a triple threat match. Sting pinned Christian while Angle made Sting submit. The ref saw submission before the pin could be made, so Kurt Angle was the new World Heavyweight Champion. But due to the controversy of the decision, the World Heavyweight title was held up, and a King of the Mountain match was set for Slammiversary. Sting lost his qualifier against Samoa Joe after interference from Christopher Daniels. The two had a very short program, culminating at Slammiversary, where Sting defeated Daniels. After the pay-per-view, Sting started teaming up with his former rival, now-turned babyface Abyss. They had a tag match at Victory Road in July, defeating AJ Styles and Tomko. They would continue their alliance after the pay-per-view, even adding the former test Andrew Martin to their team. Those three would face the Christian Coalition at Hard Justice in August in a Doomsday Chamber of Blood match, a barbed wire steel cage match where the only way to get the decision on someone is if they're bleeding. The team of Sting, Abyss, and Test won. Abyss got the decision in the match. Sting would then start a program with Kurt Angle after Hard Justice in the lead into No Surrender. Kurt had every championship in TNA. In order to keep the World Tag Team titles, Kurt needed to have a tag team partner. So there was a four-way match to determine Kurt's tag partner and co-holder of the belts, and that match was won by Sting. So reluctantly, because Sting was a babyface and Angle was a heel, the two teamed up at No Surrender to face Team Pac-Man, Ron Killings and Pac-Man Jones, and the tag team championships were on the line. Near the end of the match, Karen Angle took a dive acting like Sting hit her, Angle gave Sting the Angle Slam, and even though he wasn't supposed to do anything physical in the ring, Pac-Man Jones pinned Sting to win the World Tag Team titles. At the end of the pay-per-view, Angle still had his World Heavyweight title, Sting wanted revenge, so at Bound for Glory, we got a big dream match. Kurt Angle versus Sting for the World Heavyweight title. Sting got the win in a great match to win the belt, though Angle got the belt back on the following episode of Impact. Genesis in November saw a tag team match for the world title, Angle and Kevin Nash versus Sting and the debuting Booker T. Man who gets the decision as the world champion. Angle got the decision on Sting, retaining the belt, and this was Sting's last appearance of 2007. Sting would make his return in late March of the next year on Impact. His next pay-per-view appearance was at Lockdown. He was a part of Team Christian against Team Tomko and Lethal Lockdown, and Christian's team got the win in the match. Then we get to the next pay-per-view, Sacrifice. The World Tag Team titles became vacant, so there was going to be a tournament to determine the new champs. Four existing teams and four thrown-together teams in a Deuces Wild tournament. Sting was a part of the egotistical eight to be put together in random teams for the pay-per-view. Sting was paired with James Storm, ended up attacking him, and that led to Team 3D's victory. Sting wasn't seen much after that, which began his next program. He made his return at July at Victory Road during the Samoa Joe Booker T World Heavyweight title match. Sting thought that Joe was going too far on Booker. He tried to talk some sense into him, but Joe gave him the bird. So Sting hit him with a baseball bat. He would also attack AJ Styles after his last man standing match with Kurt Angle the following month at Hard Justice. His reasoning was that these two needed to learn respect. All the TNA originals need to start learning to respect the legends of wrestling, like him, Booker, Angle, etc. Sting put out his challenge to whomever the world champion is, come Bound for Glory in October. That would be Samoa Joe. Should be note that from May to October, Sting didn't have one match. So we get to Bound for Glory, Sting versus Joe for Joe's World Heavyweight Championship. Sting continued his streak of winning the world title at Bound for Glory, where after interference from Kevin Nash, Sting won the belt. After the pay-per-view was the formation of the Main Event Mafia. Sting, Kurt Angle, Booker T, Kevin Nash, the returning Scott Steiner. All former world champions, all legends of the wrestling business, all here to teach the TNA original some respect. This began the war between the Main Event Mafia and the TNA frontline. Sting would defend his world title against frontline members, AJ Styles at Turning Point, Jay Lethal on an episode of Impact, a four-man team of the frontline at Final Resolution, and at January's Genesis against Rhino. All of these were successful title defenses. And everything seemed to be all good with the Main Event Mafia. That was until some infighting began between Sting and Kurt Angle. Sting was the World Heavyweight Champion, however, Angle considered himself the godfather of the Mafia, and the infighting began when Sting refused to be a part of the beatdown of Brother Ray. The Mafia destroyed Brother Ray, they threw him in a dumpster, while Sting watched in the background. Eventually, Brother Ray returned, he and Devon wanted retribution on the Mafia, they wanted revenge on Kurt, and they wanted a crack at Sting's World Heavyweight title. So at Against All Odds in February, there was a four-way match between Sting, Angle, and Team 3D for the World Heavyweight title, in which Sting won. More dissension in the group led to a world title civil war at Destination X, but prior to that, Sting and Angle had an empty arena match. Nash and Steiner tried to mend the fence, but that wasn't gonna happen, and then at Destination X, Sting retained against Angle. While still infighting going on, Sting's next challenger for the title was Mick Foley. Yes, 17 years after their run against each other in WCW, these two were once again going against each other, this time for a belt. They had a match at Lockdown for the title, where Mick Foley won to become the new world champion. Sting got his rematch at the next pay-per-view Sacrifice in a four-way. It was Foley, Sting, Jarrett, and Angle, contested under Ultimate Sacrifice rules, each guy putting something on the line if they get pinned or they submit. Sting pinned Angle in the match by stipulation. While he's not the World Heavyweight Champion, he did become the godfather of the Main Event Mafia because of the win. Sting failed to qualify for King of the Mountain after losing to Angle, but at Slammiversary, Sting faced Matt Morgan. Matt wanted to join the Main Event Mafia, and Sting said he could join if he defeated him in a match at Slammiversary. Sting got the win, preventing Matt from joining. But Sting's time in the group was over, as new world champion Kurt Angle and the rest of the group attacked Sting and kicked him out of the Main Event Mafia, Kurt reclaiming his spot as the godfather of the group. Sting was once again a babyface, he wanted to destroy the Mafia. New Mafia member Samoa Joe defeated Sting at Victory Road in July, and Sting failed to capture the world title in a triple threat at August's Hard Justice. While still dealing with Kurt Angle, Sting also started a program with AJ Styles. AJ was contemplating retirement after a string of bad luck. Sting talked him out of it because he said he doesn't know how much longer he has left. He wants to pass the torch to someone great. That someone great is AJ Styles, but he won't pass the torch to a quitter. So AJ was back in the fold, back in the world title hunt, and at No Surrender, there was a five-way for the belt. Sting, AJ Styles, Kurt Angle, Matt Morgan, and Hernandez. Sting stepped aside. AJ won the match. He became the new world champion. AJ repaid Sting by giving him a title shot at Bound for Glory. The advertisement for the show was the final curtain in question form with Sting on the poster. They were really playing up that this could be Sting's final match, and the way the poster looked, him talking about passing the torch, you really thought that this was it for the icon. Sting's Bound for Glory streak came to an end when AJ defeated him to retain the belt, and this would be it for Sting, at least for the rest of 2009. Because Sting returned in 2010 for a very weird year. He returned the very first Monday Impact, then he returned again when they moved to Monday for that short period they ran that night. He was against Hulk Hogan here. The same night he attacked Hogan, he was put in a match with the debuting Rob Van Dam. RVD beat him in 10 seconds. That led to Sting beating down RVD with a baseball bat. He was also beating down Jeff Jarrett with a bat. He was talking strange talk, not making much sense at all. Sting was on the losing end of Lethal Lockdown in April. He defeated Jeff Jarrett in mere seconds at Sacrifice in May. Then he began feuding with Rob Van Dam over the World Heavyweight title. Not only did he steal the belt, he put deception on it. There was that segment where he attacked RVD with a Sting mask on, and he was talking about lifting veils, all will be revealed, still making absolutely no sense at all. At Slammiversary, RVD defeated Sting to retain the belt. Soon after, Sting would be kayfabe suspended for 30 days. Upon return from suspension, he was back in the red and black face paint. He aligned with Kevin Nash. Both were trying to, quote, save TNA from Hogan and Bischoff, but they're heels, so they must be full of shit, right? Along the way, the Pope D'Angelo De Niro joined up with them. Nash and Sting lost at No Surrender to Samoa Joe and Jeff Jarrett. Initially for Bound for Glory, it was going to be Nash, Sting, and Pope versus Joe, Jeff, and Hogan, but Hogan couldn't compete because of back injuries and surgeries. Nash, Sting, and Pope won the match after Jarrett betrayed Joe, and then Sting and Nash, who were portrayed as the heels this entire time, were actually the babyfaces here, because Hogan, Bischoff, Abyss, Jarrett, Jeff Hardy, they took over the company along with Fortune to form Immortal. Sting and Nash tried warning everyone, but they were just speaking in riddles and nonsense and nobody believed them, so why didn't they just come out and say it? Reasons, that's why. After being offered to join Immortal, they both left the arena. This would be it for Sting in 2010. After not taking WWE's offer for 2/21/11, Sting made his return to TNA in March 2011. A 3/3/11 warning was put out for world champion Jeff Hardy. That ended up being the returning Sting. He returned on the 3/3/11 episode of Impact to defeat Jeff and win the world title. Then, oh, the fucking timing on this one, the rematch at Victory Road. We all know this by now, so short story, Jeff was in no condition to compete on the night. He was pushed out there anyway. Bischoff came out and audibled the entire match. In less than 90 seconds, Sting shoot-pinned Jeff to retain the belt, and when a fan said bullshit, Sting said, I agree. Sting would still be feuding with Hogan at this point, now a full-fledged babyface. He was also defending the world title at this time, defeating Mr. Anderson and Rob Van Dam in a triple threat at Lockdown, and then Rob Van Dam in a one-on-one match at Sacrifice. Sting would feud solo against Mr. Anderson leading into Slammiversary, and to play mind games against the Icon, Anderson started dressing up as Surfer Sting. The mind games started getting to Sting, but Sting had to stay focused. Though after interference from Bischoff, Anderson defeated Sting to win the world title. After the mind games and losing the belt, Sting went insane. He snapped on Hogan, putting paint on his face. He started wearing his paint a bit different. He started talking way different. He was acting more nutty than what he was a year earlier when he was talking complete nonsense. This was the start of the insane Icon, or Joker Sting, as he's been called by fans. The Heath Ledger Joker from The Dark Knight was a big influence in this character. And Sting's character work during this time was some of the best of his entire career. That's saying a lot given the fact that here he was 52 years old, he's been 20 plus years into his career, but some great shit here. If you've never seen some or any of his Joker run, I highly suggest checking out the highlights. Sting would eventually get his rematch to Anderson in the Midsummer Nightmare. After Angle in a clown mask interfered, Sting defeated Anderson to recapture the world title. Sting would continue his Joker run in some more awesome segments. The most famous one, the one most people have seen, is the one in the office where he's in a red suit. He convinced Hogan and Bischoff he was the new network executive, only to later in the night reveal that he wasn't. He said he was because anyone in a suit is convincing. He just wanted to fuck with Hogan and Bischoff, make matches, and create some chaos. Then he released a bird at Bischoff to scare him, a callback to 1997 when he did the same thing in WCW. Sting and Kurt Angle was set to have a face match at Hardcore Justice for the world title, but after Hogan brought a chair out, Angle used it, Angle turned heel, and he became the new champion. Sting wanted a match with Hogan in the worst way possible, but the only way it was going to happen was if he defeated Ric Flair first. That was set to happen in September on an episode of Impact. Prior to that, Sting failed to recapture the title in a triple threat at No Surrender, but he would defeat Flair on Impact to get his match with Hogan. But to avoid having the match with Sting at Bound for Glory, Hogan decided to announce his retirement from wrestling. Sting knew it was bullshit. Video evidence said it was bullshit. And Sting would goad Hogan to not only keep the match on for the pay-per-view, but to put the company that he stole on the line. Sting would have to put his career on the line, but at Bound for Glory, it would be Hogan versus Sting, company versus career. And I shit you not, this ended up being better than it had any right to be at this point in time. The Philly crowd was way into this. Yes, there were a lot of smoke and mirrors, but these two had the crowd in the palms of their hands, and I dare say this was the best Sting versus Hogan match. Sting won the match, company saved, post-match Hogan turned back babyface, he and Sting stood tall. Hindsight being what it is, and given the results of the actual main event of the show, Hogan vs. Sting at Bound for Glory probably should have been the actual main event. Sting would gain a position of power within the company after Bound for Glory, becoming the general manager of the show. During this time, his in-ring workload became very rare. He would wrestle at the end of the year in a tag match on an episode of Impact, but his time here was strictly as authority. Some notable things here. The segment where he turned Jeff and Karen Jarrett against each other when he fired them was hilarious. Him telling Madison Rayne she has no power. Then you get a screaming match between the two, which on paper sounds like nails on a chalkboard, but it was actually hilarious where Sting did his best Madison Rayne impression saying he's got the power. Along the way, though, he started feuding with Bobby Roode, losing to him at Victory Road, beating him on Impact in a lumberjack match, and then eventually became number one contender for his world heavyweight title at Slammiversary. During this, he would relinquish his role as general manager to Hulk Hogan, and at Slammiversary, Sting would lose to Bobby Roode. After Slammiversary, Sting was announced as the first member of the TNA Hall of Fame to be inducted during Bound for Glory weekend, but then he was attacked by these mysterious masked men. These guys would soon reveal the name of their group as the Aces and Eights. They went after everyone in TNA. Sting led the resistance against them. At Bound for Glory, it would be two Aces and Eights members versus Sting and a mystery partner. With everyone out, Bully Ray being the only guy left, Sting says that Bully should be his partner. Hogan's not too sure about it. Sting vouches again for Bully, so Hogan agrees. Aces and Eights won at the event. Soon after, Sting was kayfabe injured by Doc, being put through a table and being hit with a ball-peen hammer. Sting would remain out the rest of 2012. He would return at the start of 2013 and continued the war against the Aces and Eights. He defeated Nux on an episode of Impact, defeated Doc at Genesis, and then won a bunch of tag matches on the road to Lockdown in March. It would be at Lockdown that Sting's team of him, Eric Young, Samoa Joe, James Storm, and Magnus defeated the Aces and Eights team in Lethal Lockdown. But at the end of the night, Bully Ray was revealed as the president of the Aces and Eights. This put a strain on Sting and Hogan's friendship because Sting vouched every single time for Bully. Bully was the leader this whole time, and Hogan put partial blame on Sting for this. But things were straightened out. The two were cool again. Sting was trying to get the world title back in the TNA camp. So after Sting defeated Matt Morgan in a number one contendership match on Impact, Sting was set to face Bully Ray at Slammiversary for the World Heavyweight title. This would be Sting's final chance at the world title, because if he loses at Slammiversary, he would no longer be able to challenge for the TNA World Heavyweight Championship, not just during Bully's reign as champion, but ever again. Bully Ray won the match after interference from Aces and Eights. Since nobody came down to save him during that match, Sting decided it was time to get the band back together. He was going to reform the Main Event Mafia, and they would destroy the Aces and Eights. Kurt Angle, Samoa Joe, Magnus, and Rampage Jackson all joined Sting for this new Mafia. They, along with AJ Styles, defeated Aces and Eights in a 10-man tag on Impact. As time went along, there was a bit of infighting in the group. There became some frustrations from Magnus after he started racking up some losses. Sting tried to calm him down, but Magnus didn't want to be calmed down. Sting had Flair to put him on the map all those years earlier. Magnus needed his Flair to do the same. So Sting and Magnus had a match at Bound for Glory that Magnus won. After Aces and Eights were forced to disband, the Main Event Mafia split up, each went on their own ways, Sting trying to teach the young guys some respect, and the others going after the World Heavyweight title. Sting would feud with Dixie Carter's kayfabe nephew, Ethan Carter III. EC3 was disrespecting a bunch of TNA names from the past, and Sting wasn't gonna stand for that. In this, Sting was also feuding with Dixie's Dixieland faction. He, along with Jeff Hardy on an episode of Impact, lost a 4-on-2 handicap match to EC3, Rockstar Spud, and the Bromans, as well as he lost a steel cage match to Bobby Roode. At the Genesis special of Impact, Sting lost to EC3 thanks to interference from World Heavyweight Champion and Dixieland member Magnus. Sting made a challenge to Magnus. He went all in on the challenge. He put his career on the line to face Magnus for the World Heavyweight title. The match was made for part 2 of Genesis on Impact. Magnus would end up defeating Sting to retain the belt, and that was Sting's final match in TNA. Sting's legacy to TNA Impact Wrestling is a big one. Him signing there at the end of 2005 really got the ball rolling on really big names going to that company. Now, some will just shoo his TNA run as he was there to take money, he wasn't really trying, it's not his WCW run, so it's not as good. And yes, it was not his WCW run. But overall, Sting's run in TNA was still a very damn good run. He had some good to great matches with a lot of different people. He had the dream matches fans wanted to see. At a time where he could just rest on laurels, he reinvented his character with the Joker and produced great television with that character. Sure, near the end, it was hard to watch at times. Him wrestling in a t-shirt, him barely being able to apply the Scorpion Deathlock, stuff like that. But had it not been for his TNA run, who knows if he would have ever came back to pro wrestling at all. This run, with all the positives and all the negatives, it gave newer fans a chance to see Sting. Hell, because of this run, I got to see Sting live, and I got to see Sting win a World Heavyweight Championship. Speaking of titles, Sting was a 5-time world champion and a 1-time tag team champion during his run in TNA. And in terms of TNA's Mount Rushmore, it's hard not to put Sting on there. But those are just my thoughts. Share your thoughts on Sting in TNA in the comments section below. Ask questions about Sting in TNA, and I'll answer them. What are some of your favorite and least favorite matches and moments of Sting in TNA? And is Sting a TNA Mount Rushmore guy? Yes, no, why not? Share all your thoughts in the comments section below. Until next time, peace.
It's the interview queen, Alicia Tu, and I would like to introduce you all to From the Vault, a weekly wrestling discussion hosted by James over on We Are Pro Wrestling on YouTube. Since 2017, From the Vault has covered various wrestling topics from the past, like pay-per-views, wrestler retrospectives, and much, much more. Make sure to subscribe and click the notification bell. Whatever episode you're actually listening to, whether current or archived, don't forget to like, comment, and share. And last but not least, like him on Facebook, follow him on Twitter, be sure to support, because you will get tons of updates on future episodes there. All links are down below, so what are you waiting for? Go enjoy. Bye!